The current situation in Turkey, by means of the freedom of expression, freedom of press, property rights, have become such a long history that we cannot really remember a time that the situation was good. Certainly, there were times that was better than today, but it was never better than, let me say, Western European countries. So when we start speaking about freedom of expression, we have to philosophize also the issue, because it is a long history. What we have been passing through in Turkey is, good guys turning bad. For two terms, the current Justice and Development Party have done quite a good job for Turkish democracy as part of the Turkish people's will to join to the European Union. Together with the people, and I can say because of the unwillingness of certain European leaders to have Turkey as a member, as a future member of the European Union, the current party lost its faith in the European Union membership process. Together with that loss of faith, in fact, they have lost their democratic agenda altogether. And to be frank, I cannot say that they always had a secret agenda of turning Turkey into a kind of, and I will use this term, particularly insistently, I will say, a mafia state. But the current situation is exactly a mafia state. Many people criticized the Justice and Development Party, which had Islamist credentials, that the Justice and Development Party had a secret agenda of turning Turkey into a Sharia state, meaning a state ruled by Islamic law. Islamic law is a law. Unfortunately, as of today in Turkey, the law does not exist, does not apply, including the very heart of the law, the constitution does not apply in the country. Already, the president himself has said that the constitution is outdated. The de facto situation is that Turkey has an executive presidential system, whereas the constitution is a parliamentary system. So he said the constitution has to be adapted into the reality, which is an executive presidential system. Well, I personally do not have a particular resistance towards an executive presidential system, but I certainly have a resistance towards that particular president to become an executive president in the country. Not because of his personality, but because of his performance in the last several years. And in his performance can be summarized as undoing what they have done in the past. So in the first two terms, about 9 years, the Justice and Development Party has done quite a good job by means of democratization, improvement of the democratic standards, freedom of expression, freedom of press, minority rights, getting rid of some of the dogmas of the Turkish society by means of the relations with the Armenians, with the Greeks, with the Kurds, and so on. So I can say under Justice and Development Party, in the first two terms, the Turkish nation was actually jumping an age mentally. But after the third term, and I can only applaud the Americans to have decided to let their presidents serve only two terms and no more. After the third term, the current president of Turkey and a group of minority within the Justice and Development Party have decided to go on their own with their own project. Of turning Turkey into a kind of anarchic state where they rule. There is no real law. I will give you examples with regards to freedom of expression and press, with regards to control of media, suppression of opposition media, and of course, suppression of rights to private property as it relates to ownership of newspapers and holdings that own newspapers also. Many people do not realize that suppression of opposition media does have a dimension of property rights also, you know, being suppressed. Whereas we have seen only very recently, in fact, a few days before the latest November 1st elections, general elections, a major media group owned by a particular businessman who is in mainly in mining and publishing industry, the prosecutors decided to overtake the managerial board of the company altogether, not only the media companies, but altogether the mining industry company also. Well, the owner of the company claims that within 2 months his company actually lost about $1 billion because of this overtaking. Well, this relates to property laws. On the other hand, this company owned two TV channels and two daily newspapers, which were mainly the venue where the parliamentary and extra-parliamentary opposition was able to express their feelings about what's going on in the country. So by means of silencing those TV channels and newspapers, the current government, well, I'm not going to say the government altogether, but as I use the term, a minority within the current government, and particularly the office of the president, has managed to silence the opposition altogether. And only a week ago, the editor-in-chief and the Ankara representative, this is usually number two, of a newspaper of Cumhuriyet Daily have been arrested because of their journalistic activities. The issue relates to certain trucks that were carrying weaponry into Syria. We don't know to whom they were going, but well, this newspaper decided to publish the photographs of those trucks with weaponry on them. And it's already over a year that the issue passed by. The current press law suggests that only within 4 months of publication of an item, the prosecutor can sue a journalist if the content is problematic. It is over 4 months now. It's over a year actually after their publication. But it seems that the president personally has sworn that he is going to revenge for the publication of this news item. In fact, we have not come to here just in one day. For the last 3 years, almost 4 years, the Turkish media has been bleeding, has been losing grounds by means of their freedom of expression. The numbers are changing every other day, so I cannot give you exact numbers, but as of four days ago, the number of journalists who have lost their positions in their newspapers because of a phone call that came from the president's office or because of indirect influence of this new minority, as I call them, 1,562 journalists lost their jobs all around Turkey. This is a huge number. Given the fact that the overall number of journalists is not more than 5,000 people, you know, in the country. And when I speak about journalists, I'm not taking into account the citizenship journalism or social media journalism. I'm speaking about, you know, conventional media, meaning those people were making their bread and butter from their jobs. Losing their jobs, they lost actually their bread and butter. So this has influence on their families, on their, you know, financial relations and so on. So it's not just suppression of opposition. I will speak on a few strategies of the current government by means of how the government managed to oppress or suppress, if you will, the opposition media and convert some of the opposition media into pro-government media. We are accustomed to see authoritarian regimes, you know, suppressing opposition newspapers. We have the examples of Venezuela. You know, Middle East is, you know, yesterday I was speaking to students in University of North Carolina, an Arab student stood up and he said, well, despite the fact that the story you have been telling is a very painful story, still Turkish situation is better than Jordanian or Egyptian situation, he said, and he is right. The point is, we are not coming to current situation from a worse position. We are coming to current situation from a rather good position. We have done, the Turkish people altogether have done quite well by means of improving the democratic standards of Turkey, but we are now losing grounds. One major strategy of converting opposition media into pro-government media is accusation. An accusation has several different versions, but the overall strategy is either directly buying a media group or having a friendly businessman who enters into public tenders, meaning makes money out of public tenders, public bids. Buy a newspaper group or media group, TV channels and so on, and by time convert their editorial line into a pro-government position. So when, for example, we look at Turquoise Media Group, which does own several newspapers, magazines, TV channels and so on, which used to be an opposition media group back in 2002, it was converted into pro-government media when it was bought by a you know, friendly businessman, friendly in the sense that friendly to the president, then the prime minister. And we have seen even in 2009, when during the acquisition of the media group, the prime minister then was personally involved by means of arranging the money, because the businessman himself didn't want to be involved in media business, because apart from a few newspapers, Turkish TV channels or newspapers are not profitable. You don't enter into media business because it is a feasible business to make money. You enter into media business because you need newspapers for lobbying. If you are in construction industry, this is the locomotive sector of private industry in Turkey, you will be doing business by means of road construction, you know, huge public tenders, airports, bridges, and so on. So you will need a media group that will actually lobby on behalf of your business. Or if you are in mining industry, if you are in energy industry, these industries are not settled down yet, meaning that governments are making every other day a new regulation, a new law. So you will need a media group to lobby on behalf of your own business, or sometimes even cover up your dirty job. If you are in a business like textile industry, why should you need a newspaper or TV channel? Because you cannot do anything. You know, the latest laws about textile industry were made in 1933. Nothing new is being done there. Public tenders are very small by means of textile industry acquisitions and so on. So you are private altogether, you don't need newspapers. So only people who benefit from owning media groups for their other businesses are in media business. That, of course, puts newspapers in a rather problematic situation, meaning, on the one hand, you, as a journalist, will need to save your ethics, you know, journalistic objectivity, neutrality, and so on. But on the other hand, you will have to take care of the interests of your business boss. And most, more often than not, those interests are linked to the interests of the governing party also. So you cannot just criticize the government knowing that your boss is going to enter a public tender a week later. And particularly in industries like mining concessions, the prime minister, then now the president, has the final authority to sign or unsign a contract. This means that, and it has happened several times, we have seen, for example, in one particular case, the president didn't like the company that took a public tender, that won a tender about production of, cars for the army. These are armored cars. So he calls another businessman and says, why don't you apply to this and that public office, then we will cancel the other tender, and then you will enter, we will give it to you, and it happened. It happened. So this, Turkey is a country that, I don't know the exact number now, but as of about 3 months ago, within 13 years of Justice and Development Party rule, the public tender law was changed 169 times. In order to fit the law into each and every new public tender. So under those conditions, we cannot say newspapers are free to write everything they want. And yes, businessmen enter into media business just in order to have the consent of the government. In fact, on several occasions, we know that it's not the businessman himself or herself that decides to buy a media group. It is actually a suggestion that comes from the president's office or prime minister's office. He says, go and buy this newspaper group and pay them whatever they want, and I will give you further orders after you buy it. And we have seen that after acquisition of such media groups, large numbers of opposition, or critical, let me say, journalists have lost their positions, and newspapers were converted into pro-government positions by time. But very recently, with the case of the IPEC Media Group that I mentioned already, the two TV channels and two newspapers and other magazines also, they have found something else, because acquisition necessitated financial, transactions. It needed money to be found, and you were buying, you were paying for it. Instead, now they have found a new way of taking over a media group. A prosecutor comes out and says, I have reasonable suspicion about this particular media group, that the media group is actually serving the aims of a terroristic organization, which is working to overthrow the current government and so on. So I think there is reasonable suspicion that this news media group is going to continue on this activity, so the government has to overtake the board of managers of the media group. Well, when you take over the board of managers, you actually take over the whole company. And this has happened to IPEC Media Group. And in such a case, the conversion of the media group from an opposition media group into a pro-government media group takes place within days. You have to see, for example, the front cover of Bugün Daily that was published a day before the taking over of the newspaper, and a day after the taking of the newspaper, and a day before, in fact, it was another news item about illegitimate transmission of air maimens into some Syrian opposition groups. Certainly a blow on the face of the current regime in Turkey. A day after, the headline read, the president or the public, they use the same term for it in Turkish, Cumhur, is in the streets. And we see the current president of Turkey saluting the people on during a national feast. So suddenly he became the headlines in those newspapers. Well, this is the swiftest conversion of an opposition media group into a pro-government media group within days. And what is better, well, I am just trying to be sarcastic here. What's better for the government is they didn't pay anything for that. In fact, they are paying their pro-government journalists who have started to work in those newspapers now with the money of an opposition businessman. And they are paying huge sums, you know. I don't know what the previous editor-in-chief of that particular newspaper was taking, but most probably the new editor-in-chief is taking 10 times more than the previous one. So conversion is being taken care of, and some friendly journalists who were not making good amount of money in their previous newspapers are being moved from those pro-government newspapers into the newly converted media group. They are given, you know, hierarchically better jobs there, you know, being, for example, a simple worker at the advertisement department of a pro-government newspaper. A particular guy now is editor-in-chief of a newspaper, and of course much better paid, and not with the money of the government or a pro-government businessman, but with the money of the opposition. I will pass into another strategy that is being applied, I would say creatively, in Turkey by means of oppressing media. This is tax audit. It's not a secret that tax audit is the worst thing that can come to your door. And if the audits want to fine you, there's no way to escape from them. In the Turkish case, we have heard amazing stories that the tax audits sent by the government to opposition newspapers or media group or businesses sometimes even said, you know why we have come? Just give us the evidence, we will just find you and go. Otherwise it will take days, months to take care of, to find something to find you. But the overall aim is just to punish you, and you know why? The earliest example actually took place with Doğan Media Group. Doğan Media Group is still the largest media group in Turkey by means of the number of newspapers, daily newspapers and TV channels that they own. And Doğan Media Group has been a staunch critique of the current government, even from the very early days of the Justice and Development Party government. And the first fine came about tax issue, and the amount was huge. It was about $4 billion. No particular group can pay such a fine. And the response of the businessman, of course, was to ask for a kind of settlement. And the settlement came by. They asked that media group to sell two of their newspapers to a friendly businessman, so that they will be converted into pro-government newspapers. To fire some of the journalists that the president's office was not happy with. And it happened. You know, certain journalists that were working about 40 years in the same newspaper were actually fired from the newspaper. Why? Because in return for that, the fine was taken down to less than half a million US dollars. In order to survive, Doğan Media Group had to settle down the issue. But the point is this, and I have to finish with this, you know, to leave enough time for a Q&A session. I am observing a kind of lessons of Czechoslovakia. I'm sure most of you are knowledgeable about the lessons of Czechoslovakia. When Hitler wanted Czechoslovakia, at that time, many European leaders said, okay, he wants that country, let us give him the country and we will have peace of mind. But the dictators are never tired of asking for more. If you give them some, they will ask for more. Because the body grows and the body needs more nurturing. And the Dawn Media Group had settled down that case, but that this minority in the president's palace is not settled down with the problem. So they have been asking them for further concessions. Only a few days after the latest electoral victory of Justice and Development Party, we have seen an advisor of the president speaking openly, publicly, in a TV channel actually, inviting Dawn Media Group to fire certain journalists that they didn't like. And within a month following that speech, we have seen that actually two of those journalists are already fired. One actually fired only today. So it seems that even the strongest media group, Dawn Media Group, when it comes to being suppressed by the government, they cannot say no. And as of today, Dawn Media Group has moved towards a neutral stance by means of the government. They are sometimes criticizing, but sometimes giving support to undemocratic activities of the government and so on. And the trend is towards becoming a pro-government media by time. The only plausible media group that is not really open to these kinds of ways of suppression is my media group, Zaman Media Group. We are not owned by an industrialist. Up until 2 years ago, we were certainly a profitable media group. I cannot say the same as of today because we have been losing advertisement income due to pressuring of the advertisers. And I have to underline this, that it's not just a macro level, it's not a macro level strategy only, they are working at the micro levels, you know. We, for example, are marketing our newspaper on subscription based, and there's almost no subscriber of my newspaper that didn't receive a phone call, a kind of threat from their neighbors, or the office of the governing party, suggesting that they are going to suffer because they are a subscriber of our newspaper. That's a micro-level strategy against any kind of opposition media. Well, I will have to say a few words about what can be done and what the United States of America has been doing. Unfortunately, we have not heard a strong voice from Washington, D.C. And historical and geostrategical importance of Turkey has become once again indispensable for the United States and for European Union. For United States in the war against terrorism, particularly the ISIS terrorism in Syria and Iraq, for Europe in using Turkey as a watchdog of Europe's borders against the flux of refugees into Europe, Turkey has become a good friend that is needed. And certainly the Cold War 2.0 has already started between the NATO alliance and Russia, on the other hand. And during such a Cold War era, security issues become more important than freedom issues. It's not acceptable, but it is understandable why Washington, D.C. and European capitals are not vocal enough in their criticism of the trend of authoritarianization in Turkey. But I have to underline something. Turkish democracy is a U.S. investment. Turkish democracy is a U.S. investment. Taxpayers, American taxpayers paid for emergence of Turkish democracy. Turkish democracy was given to us. It was not gained by us. We didn't fight for democracy. It was actually created, particularly multi-party democracy was created as a part of Truman Doctrine and the Marshall Plan that actually pooled billions of US dollars into the region, particularly Turkey and Greece. And what is happening in Turkey is actually corruption and destruction of the U.S. investment in Turkish democracy. Sometimes countries, you know, global players like United States, may be thinking that it is better to work with a dictator which is more predictable than a people. Because sometimes people become unpredictable and they may choose crazy options. But I have to underline this particular dictator is more unpredictable than the Turkish nation. So the Turkish nation is still the best possible option as an ally for the interests of the United States in the region. The Turkish people are still largely democratic, and as the intellectuals of Turkey, we are still quite optimistic about the future of our country. Of course, I have started with a painful story, but this doesn't mean that we will give up. We will certainly fight for the future of our democracy. Thank you very much for your patience.
You said the nation is more predictable than a dictator, but no one predicted their success in the elections. That's very interesting, isn't it?
Well, in fact, to be frank, their success was predicted, but this much was unpredicted. Unpredicted, not in the sense that internationally established, IR laws wouldn't be able to predict it. In most of the established democracies, when there is a security threat, nationwide security threat, people vote for the strongest political party because they know only a strong government can deliver security and stability. So given the fact that between June the 7th, when the current government lost their parliamentary majority in the sense that enough majority to establish single party government, and in November 1st, the rerunning of the election, there were two major ISIS operations in Turkey, suicide bombings, that overall claimed 160-some lives. One was in the center of Ankara. Certainly, if a terrorist attack takes place in the capital city, its perception is much, much bigger than the numbers. So that level of perceived insecurity normally pushes people to vote for the main, the strongest political party, and Justice and Development Party was the strongest party. But the point is, in the Turkish case, the Turkish nation didn't do that in the past. In 1993, for example, there was again a surge of PKK terrorism at that time, but the people voted for not the first largest party, not the second largest party, but the third largest party. So Turkish people had a unique way of voting under conditions of insecurity. They were not going towards the largest party, but they were criticizing the largest party because of the failure of creating a secure environment. So because of that, most of us were thinking that the nation would repeat itself and say, okay, if there is insecurity in the country, yes, of course, the terrorist organizations are responsible for this, but we are not voting for terrorist organizations. We cannot outvote terrorist organizations. We are voting for government. So in the election day, the government is responsible for the insecurity. The government should have been responsible for a suicide attack that took place in the center of Ankara. So we were expecting that the people would punish the government, but it didn't take place. It seems that if the, and this is quite related to the suppression of opposition media, because the Turkish people are being informed mainly from TV channels. They're not reading newspapers. The national newspapers we sell daily are about 4.5 million out of a population of 79 million people. So we are an under-reading society, but we are overwatching. So TV channels are very important, and unfortunately the current government has a very strong control of TV channels, particularly in news channels. Under those conditions, the people were not really informed about what's happening, what's taking place. Yes, it would be better for me to guess a victory before the elections, but after the elections, at least I can explain why it happened.
Any questions? Please.
Kerim Bey, thank you very much for your comments. It's very disturbing what you're telling us over here. We're following it, so I have a couple of points. Of those 1,500 journalists who have lost their jobs, how many are in jail now? Number one, I know quite a few are in jail. And yeah. I've asked even the principal advisor of Erdogan's government, who spoke to us in the National Press Club some months ago, why are they in jail? And he said they're Kurds and they're terrorists and so on. I was going to say, I don't believe a word you're saying. And I didn't, number one. Number two, is the National Assembly now a rubber stamp? And does that mean that Erdogan will be able to change the constitution and make himself president for life?
Thank you very much for
Or for afterlife.
For afterlife.
No, I can't think of this.
Why not?
Well, as of today, the number of journalists who are in jail is, I think it was 29, added two more now, so it should be 31. And the numbers are going to grow because only in the last 2 weeks, I think about 10 senior journalists have been invited to courthouses for under the Article 299 of Turkish Penal Code. Article 299 is our new Article 301. You will remember that we had this, you know, infamous Article 301 about defamation of Turkishness. Article 299 is about defamation of the president. And there are certain court houses in Turkey that take look at only defamation of the president cases all day long, defamation. The overall number of cases that were opened, you know, the president is in the office not for 2 years now, you know, more than 1 year but less than 2 years, and the number of cases opened against, you know, students, journalists, Twitters, and so on, is over 1,000 cases. So I would say it's almost impossible not to defame the president if you are speaking about the president. Whatever you say can become a defamation. Hasan Cemal, a really senior journalist, had to visit the courthouse because of an article he wrote titled "Hey You." Okay, and well,
you can't say you. You have to say Yunus.
Your Highness.
Your Yunus.
So the situation is not good. One of my close friends, Bülent Keneş, editor in chief of Today's Zaman, is in a process of being sued by the prime minister, not the president in this case, by the prime minister, and the prosecutor wants 8 years of jail imprisonment because of a tweet that he didn't write. He retweeted of a tweet of the main opposition party leader. Another friend of ours, a journalist, Sevgi Akarçeşme, was sued because of a comment somebody else wrote down the tweet that she tweeted. Okay, so
You have to have long disclaimers.
That is the issue. That is the reason why I started my presentation that Turkey is no longer a state of law. It's not just the constitution is not being taken care of, but the law itself is not being taken care of. Just not to take too much of your time, I have to say this. A good friend of mine in London who is trying to explain the situation in the country was making a presentation in the House of Lords about the situation, and there were, of course, friendly lords, friendly meaning friends of Turkey. And he said, look, we are going to tell you a story, but it will be very difficult for you to believe what's happening in my country. But believe me, I am trying to belittle the story because the overall story is completely unbelievable. Now, we are not telling the whole story because you won't believe it. There is a saying in English, you say, too good to be correct, yes? Well, edit another one, too bad to be correct, okay? Now, if I were here to tell you the whole story, you would say, no, this cannot be correct in this age. Well, this is correct in this age. The overtaking of IPEC Media Group that I mentioned already were made by a prosecutor who claimed that the overall tax auditing process that took place about 2 years didn't produce any wrongdoing in the business of this particular businessman. And in this age of corruption, it is impossible to think of a company to have not done anything wrong. So the fact that the papers are so perfect gives a suspicion that they're all forged. So this is the reason why the media group is taken over, because they couldn't find anything wrong. And the fact that they couldn't find anything wrong has become the reason of the, well, they call it reasonable suspicion. You know, universally, there is a right of prosecutors to, you know, apprehend a person, ask for detainment if there is strong suspicion. In the Turkish case, it is reasonable suspicion. And the term reasonable is an unreasonable term. You know, it changed according to the reason of the person. And the reason of the Turkish government is, unreasonable, certainly unreasonable. I'm not going to say, you know, would you think downing a Russian jet is reasonable? I'm not going to say that. But the fact that the Turkish government has been, well, the prosecutors, friendly prosecutors, are using the loopholes in the Turkish laws in order to jail opposition journalists. And the number in the past was huge and true. In the past there were several Kurdish journalists who were jailed because of their journalistic activity. A journalist can suggest a federal system, can suggest this disintegration of the state. This is freedom of expression. But whenever the president in the past were asked about the jailed journalist, the number was as large as 119 in the past. A majority of them were let free, and we have to underline this also. Not everything is bad. Sometimes good things are happening also. But the point is, those people were not opposition. They were not opposition to this particular government. They were in jail before this government came to power, so they are let free. But now the empty rooms left behind are being filled with opposition journalists, and these are senior journalists. And it seems that the numbers are going to grow. And, well, you may say, okay, if there is rule of law in the country, why are you afraid of being jailed? You will see the judge within a few days, and then the judge is going to decide lawfully, justly, and so on. But it is not the case. The editor-in-chief of Samanyolu Media Group is in jail for over 1 year now, and still the indictment is not written. There is no indictment. So he does not know why he is in jail. What are the evidences against him? So And this can take up to 5 years. The Turkish law says the prosecutor has 5 years. Within 5 years, he has to prepare the indictment. So after 5 years, you will have the president again a president. You have asked whether the Turkish parliament can block, for example, a change of the constitutional amendment. The current configuration of the government has given, of the parliament, has given the government the majority to establish a single party government, but it doesn't give them the majority, the absolute majority that they need in order to make a constitutional amendment. But 2/3 majority is enough to go for a referendum. And in order to have 3/5 majority, they will need only 17 extra seats. And these 17 extra seats can come either from the Kurdish Nationalist Party or from the Turkish Nationalist Party. And the bargaining bit is the same thing. So if he says, I will continue on, if the president says, okay, I will continue on with the rapprochement, with the peace process, with the PKK, then he will have those necessary seats from the Kurdish Nationalist Party. If he says, okay, I will never turn back to the table with the Kurds, then he will have the same votes from the Nationalist Party. So he has the bargaining bit. So he will certainly be able to pass it from the parliament if he really wants to. When it comes to the referendum, whether the Turkish people will vote for a parliament, an executive presidential system, believe me, current system is not a system. There is a de facto situation where the Turkish president is stronger than any Ottoman sultan. None of the Ottoman sultans had the power to, to get rid of the control, the checks and balances. The ulema, the classical jurisprudence, I would say, were free. And in fact, the jurisprudence had the power to dismiss the sultan, and not the sultan the power to dismiss the head of the jurisprudence. So compared to the Ottoman sultans, certainly current president, as our journalist friend, and I am going to repeat what he said, who is already in jail because of an article that they published, I mentioned already, John, that he was interviewed by, I think, BBC, if I'm not wrong, and he says he's a dictator. And the journalist, BBC journalist, says, but he's elected. And he says he's an elected dictator. He is an elected dictator, and he can be re-elected, and he can manage to pass. Given, once again, I'm saying, this is a freedom of expression issue. This is a freedom of press issue. Given the fact that the current government controls 17 TV channels, 8 newspapers, by means of controlling, fully controls the editorial room, newsroom of those newspapers and TV channels, there is no chance that the opposition will be able to reach out to the public. On the other hand, if it was the topic today, I would, of course, criticize the opposition parties also in Turkey. If a part of our problem is the government and authoritarian trends of the president's office, another part of our problem is the fact that there is no reasonable, well, the term reasonable is not good here, there is no feasible opposition in the country that people would say, okay, I'm going to vote for this opposition party because it also offers me stability, it also offers me security, it also gives me a sense that these people can also run the country. So many of my friends, when I suggest them not to vote for this particular party, they say, okay, for whom? For whom I should vote? But this is not the topic of today's meeting. Most probably, if it comes to the referendum, only the simple logic, okay, that already the president is an executive president. The latest example, is the fact that he went to Qatar to sign the deals and to start the first meeting of strategic high-level strategic meeting. Normally, Prime Minister heads the high-level strategic meeting. High-level strategic meetings is a system Turkey established with several countries, is actually joint cabinet meeting, meaning the Prime Minister of that country and ministers of that country and Turkish Prime Minister and ministers are coming together, and as you know, this is a biannual meeting. No, they are doing twice a year, every 6 months. Meeting that takes place with friendly countries. But this time the Turkish Prime Minister didn't go, it was the President that joined the strategic meeting. Well, in G20 meeting in Antalya that took place, normally it should have been the Turkish Prime Minister that would be the host of the event, because he is the, constitutionally, he is the head of execution in the country, but he didn't show up here. It was the President that hosted the people. And it seems that we are stuck with this man.
Any questions? Yes, Lori.
I have two questions. The first is, perhaps it would have been different had the EU been a little bit more promising to Turkey as potentially becoming a member. But now it seems Turkey needs the EU as much as the EU needs Turkey, perhaps. Is there any ability there, do you think, for that relationship to help influence freedom of press in Turkey? My second one is sort of the opposite, which is, what's the influence of Putin and Russia on your president and your government?
Well, the burden of the second question is on my shoulders, so together with that burden, I am going to try to answer the first one also. Well, the point is this, it seems that the leaders of Europe and the leaders of Turkey, the current leaders of Turkey, have come to a mutual understanding that there is no way Turkey will become a member of European Union, so it is better to get what the most out of that process. And it, think of it, you know, we are now celebrating, not myself, but the Turkish people have been asked to celebrate the fact that we will be given free travel visa or visa-free rights in Europe in return for preventing Syrians to enter into Europe. So I will say, we are going to enter European lands in return for not letting Syrians enter the European lands. It suggests that there are two bad guys outside, but the one that is less bad is taken in return for preventing the other one. So we are still unwanted in Europe. And it seems that the Turkish government is quite happy with the fact that this visa-free regime is going to take place. In fact, there are still 72 conditions in the agreement between Turkey and European Union. Turkey has to take care of those 72 conditions. But unfortunately, freedom of expression and freedom of press, despite they are being mentioned in those 72 conditions, it's just mentioned as an item, not a concrete conditions. For example, they could have said abolishing Article 299. They could have said abolishing any kind of imprisonment sentence for journalists, for journalistic activities. They could have said, all 29 or now 31 journalists in jail had to be set free and so on. These are concrete steps that had to be mentioned. They are not mentioned at all. We have to understand Europe. As I said, this is unacceptable but understandable. We know why they are doing this, why they are not really behaving ethical when it comes to speak for further democratization in the country. Syrian refugee issue is a huge problem for Europe. And it's not just refugees that has to be, you know, settled down. It is bringing in new ideologies. It's bringing in a new stream of new ways of life that has to be coped with. So they are going to be stuck in Turkey. I don't know what Turkey will do in order to, you know, integrate them into the Turkish public. But well, I don't think that the European Union is going to have a real influence on the Turkish government by means of, you know, thinking twice if they want to overtake, let me say, my newspaper, for example. Okay, let us gamble a bit, you know. If till the end of this year they don't come with a similar pretext, suggesting that Zaman Media Group is also supporting a terroristic organization. Who knows what is a terroristic organization in this sense? And for that reason, it is going to be overtaken by the government. If they don't come within, we have just 1 month, okay? If they don't come within 1 month, then, okay, I will be more optimistic about the influence of European Union. But we have been hearing rumors that they are getting prepared for overtaking, that this is the largest circulating newspaper and the latest castle of opposition in the country. When Zaman is gone, there's no other that can stand in front of the government. Let me pass to the impact of involvement of Russia. You know. The influence of Putin seems to be multifaceted. First of all, that minority that I mentioned, that is basically around the president and are creating a personal cult around the president, are also fond of Mr. President. I will just repeat one particular sentence or statement from chief advisor of the president, Yiğit Bulut. He suggested that there are 2.5 leaders in the world. One is Mr. Erdogan, of course. The second is Mr. Putin, and half leader is Mr. Obama.
What a credit for Obama!
So this is one you know side of the input. We have seen at least about 2 years ago, Turkish Prime Minister then was in Moscow, and Moscow was quite critical of NATO operations and so on. And Turkish Prime Minister said, "Okay, take us into Shanghai organization, and let us get rid of this headache named NATO." It suggests that I'm not going to say that the Turkish government has already made its mind to become a part of the Asian alliance, Russian, Chinese, Iranian, and so on. But it seems that that minority is playing with the idea, or at least using the fact that there is an alternative out there in Shanghai. As a bargaining bid for NATO. Of course, Turkey is not just the president's palace. We have a very strong army that has political influence. We do still have an opposition in the country. It's certainly an intellectual opposition. The Kurdish opposition is a real opposition. Alevite opposition is a real opposition in the country. And being a kind of intellectual opposition movement, Hizmet movement, is certainly a real, concrete opposition group. So the Turkish government is not free to do whatever they want. The very fact that the acquisition deal of missiles from China was cancelled very recently suggests that the Turkish army still is quite influential on the decisions of the government. There is no way, in my understanding, that Turkey will change its direction towards the East. East in the sense that, not Middle East, but in the sense of Russian-Chinese alliance. I don't know if there is a Chinese-Russian alliance at all. Certainly Shanghai is not an alternative for European Union, not an alternative for NATO alliance, certainly. Given the fact that Russia is involved in Syrian affairs, our friends, when I say our, I mean the Turkish government's friends in Syria are enemies of Russia in Syria, and Turkish government's enemies in Syria are friends of Russia, suggests a dichotomy between Turkey and Russia, particularly in Syria, and it is the most imminent problem for Turkey. Under such conditions, I don't think that Moscow is an axis for Turkey to turn towards. Turkey is still and has to continue on being a NATO ally, and in that sense, United States has the upper hand by means of influencing domestic policies also. So I would expect more from Washington D.C. by means of freedom of press and freedom of expression than European Union, because Europe needs Turkey more than Turkey needs Europe. But on the other hand, given the current situation in Syria, Turkey needs United States more, much more than United States needs Turkey. In such a condition, U.S. certainly held the upper hand by means of asking for what a reasonable, again, problematic term used here, friendship necessitates.
Why don't they ask it then, if you think they have the upper hand? Why just tolerate the level of jerkness, so to speak, that's coming out of?
Well, first of all, I think together with the imprisonment of left-wing journalists, Washington D.C. is going to rethink its position. Because up until now, the opposition groups that were being suppressed by the government were not at home in Washington D.C. I will use a very neutral term. But when it comes to names like Can Dündar and Hasan Cemal and Cengiz Çandar, and they are in the line after Can Dündar, I think Washington D.C. is going to rethink its position vis-à-vis Turkish applications. In that sense, I'm not expecting total silence. But on the other hand, Turkey has proved that even Washington D.C., when Washington D.C. is quite openly critical of Turkish positions, Turkey has a certain level of resilience. We have seen in Cyprus, for example. Certainly, Turkish position in Cyprus was criticized by the United States, but Turkish government managed to go by it. And there are urgencies. ISIS is a real urgency, and it is an urgency for us. Even the Turkish opposition would, as an opposition figure, I would say, okay, let us leave our differences aside for some time. Let us get rid of this ISIS problem. And even if you are going to oppress us later on, not now. Okay? Until then, we can keep silent. Okay? Because this external threat is there to stay. And who is going to be Pakistan of Syria? Turkey. When United Kingdom joins, when Germany joins bombing ISIS frontiers in Syria, where are they going to run into? The map says into Turkey. I don't want to think of what kind of a country we are going to become. If that moves into, this is exactly what happened in Afghanistan. Yes, the bombings in Afghanistan, U.S. bombings in Afghanistan worked well by means of killing the terrorists, not the terrorism, but the terrorists. But then what happened? They ran to the more mountainous areas in Pakistan, and Pakistan is a failed state now. And the same holds for Syria. They're not going to run into the desert areas in Saudi Arabia or Jordan, which is open area, open for air strikes. They're going to run into mountainous areas, One option is Kurdish areas, Iraqi Kurdistan, which is heavily guarded. The other option is Turkish lands, East Turkey, which is quite mountainous areas, and it is almost impossible to fight guerrilla warfare there. And already there is an established kind of grassroots for radical Islamists in the name of Hezbollah there, which will certainly collaborate with ISIS militants in, you know, flying into Turkey. So I think European Union is making a grave mistake by means of thinking of Turkey as a watchdog for refugees only. Well, stopping the refugees in the Aegean Sea border, meaning the border between Greece and Turkey, is a mistake. They had to be stopped in the border between Turkey and Syria, because once they are in Turkey, they are certainly going to bring in ISIS militants also, then we may find Turkey not as a target country for ISIS, but as a hometown for ISIS.
I wish we had more time, but please join me in thanking Kerim Balci. Thank you so much.